Psalm 105, 17 to 20. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they ought with feathers. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came. The word of somebody coming right now. Amen. The word of the Lord tried him. The king sent and loosed him, even the ruler of the people, and let him go free. There is somebody here. Today is your day of freedom. Yeah. And concerning Nigeria, we are trusting God that this particular independence we are celebrating shall be the independence that we truly bring forth independence. Yeah. In this nation. Yeah. When I was meditating on this scripture, the Almighty God laid it in my heart that the situation of Nigeria is synonymous to what happened to Joseph. The people outside, can you hear me? Can I see them? Because I expect that they should be able, we cannot see them. Not yet. Not yet. Okay. Because we have made provision for camera outside some days ago. I expected, no problem. If you can hear me, shout hallelujah. You are blessed for life already, sir. So when I was meditating on this, the Holy Spirit dropped in my heart that the situation of Nigeria happened to be similar to that of Joseph. Joseph had a dream. Because of that dream, he was bound. He suffered many things. Nigeria too. The founding fathers of Nigeria during 1960 Independence Day of period, they had a dream that one day Nigeria will be so high. It was a glorious dream. That one day Nigeria will be among the nations that will be calling shots in the world. They had a dream. Joseph also had a dream. In the book of Genesis chapter 37 verse 9, Genesis 37 verse 9, remember that he dreamed another dream. And they had a dream in this country that one day, even the ones that have gone ahead of them, nations, they will come and be bound to them. Joseph had that kind of dream. And he dreamed yet another dream and told his brethren and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars shall make obeisance, they will bow to me. Nigeria also had a dream. The founding fathers of Nigeria had a dream. Nigeria has been blessed by God with so many mineral resources and even agricultural part. We are blessed. Diverse resources. Are you talking about coal? Gold. There are some places in Nigeria you have the crude oil. Cocoa. Many nations don't have one tenth of what these nations have. Blessed with diverse resources. Like Joseph too. His father blessed him with a coat of many colors. There are similarities, Nigeria and Joseph. In the book of Genesis chapter 37 verse 3. Genesis 37, 3. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his brethren, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him what? He made him a coat of many colors. Praise the Lord. Nigeria has so many colorful resources. From east to west, north, south, everywhere. Many of them are not even tapped yet. But one thing led to another. The people that were supposed to be caretakers of Nigeria, they stripped Nigeria of the coat of many colors. The elder brother of Joseph, you would have expected that maybe the enemy, his own blood the ones from his father and mother, they were the ones that stripped him. In the book of Genesis chapter 37, 23 and 24. Genesis 37, 23 and 24. And it came to pass when Joseph was come unto his brethren, that they stripped Joseph out of his coat, his coat of many colors, diverse resources, that was on him. And they took him and cast him into a pit, and the pit was empty. There was no water in it. Praise the Lord. Nigeria too was stripped of many wealth by the people that were supposed to be in charge. And they carted many of them to foreign accounts. Take care of this nation. But they were taking care of themselves at the detriment of the nation. And they did not even do that. They now pushed Joseph into the pit. Nigeria has been in the pit for a long time. And they now sold their brother out to foreigners. Foreigners come and get cheap labor and they maltreat our people. And their brother selling out some countries. What they are not able to, some companies, what they are not able to do in their nation, they prosper. You know, they, some of them are just being appended of late. They say, oh, yeah, pay back this thing, or we shut down your company. Okay, we'll pay back over time. It should not be. Somebody sold out. They sold Joseph out. And the people that even came, the Ishmaelites, they came, you would think that, okay, so that this guy will not die, let us carry him away. They carry him away and he became a slave. In the book of Genesis chapter 37, Genesis 37, 27 and 28. Genesis 37, 27 and 28. Come and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother, and our flesh, and his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midianites, merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph. You may think that that was a good thing, but it was there for their own benefit. Out of the pit, and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Joseph into Egypt. Praise the Lord. A nation with so many resources now became a prisoner. True, it was the Europeans that actually first discovered some of the things that we are calling our resources. And they came. But many of them, they did not come with the art of being philanthropist, even though they made it to affairs or schools, railway. But many of those things were to challenge and assist the taking of the resources at our detriment, but to service their nation. They used those 20 years to build up their nation and their economy. And they set up situation that the nation will still be dependent on them. That's why most of their products, including, we still get from them. Even the products, they will still get. Everything was just, the sellout was so bad. But the Almighty God will set Nigeria free. Amen. I said that the Almighty God shall set this nation free. Amen. In the name of Jesus. That's what happens when the people that are supposed to take care of the younger brother were the ones selling out. One of the problems of any nation or any organization that will not be doing well is the problem of leadership. In the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 10, 16 and 17, Ecclesiastes chapter 10, 16 and 17, the Bible says that woe unto that nation, that their Leaders are babies. Not people physically, but in thinking. They can't see far. Say that, that means you will be in it. That means you will suffer. Say that, their leaders happen to be people that can't see far. How did that nation go far? Woe to thee, O land, when thy king is a child, and thy princes, one in assembly, eat in the morning. No discipline. They can't hold themselves. Blessed be thou, O land, when thy king is the son of noble, and the princes eat in due season. They just take things. They know when to do things, when to talk, when to do, when to take, when not to take. For strength, and not for what? And not for drunkenness. If this is just telling us about leadership, must be discipline. You cannot demand what you cannot manifest yourself. This issue of do as I say, not as I do, won't stop. For things to actually, if you want hospital, you must, you know.
Go ahead, boss.
Amen.
You cannot leave the healthcare in a devastating state and you keep on flying about trying to take care, doing medical checkup. It does not work that way. Not do as, and when it gets to the point of, and we also go there, that mentality will cause resources to go there, so that when I have anything to check, I know it's sound. Jesus Christ was speaking about leadership. He said that the mentality of being in leadership, trying to do election, trying to just fight, going to do it, trying just to get there. You don't understand what a leader is, or who a leader is. A leader is a servant. That, he said that the people of the world, they lord it over. They see leaders are oppressors. That until that mentality changes, the nothing changes. In the book of Matthew chapter 20, 25. Matthew 20, 25 to 28. And Jesus called them unto him and said, ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them. And they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him do what? Let him be your minister. Let him serve you. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give life, to give his life a ransom for many. True leadership is a life of sacrifice. True leadership. Until our leaders, all of us, and we are all leaders in our own right. So when you're saying leaders, don't be looking at just the people on top of you. Fine, the spotlight is basically on the ruling leaders. So we are also leaders. True leadership is a life of sacrifice. When people cannot sacrifice, they have no business contesting for election. They don't have any business. Look at many that I give my life as a ransom. Ransom means that they will collect something to release another. Say that this life, let these people enjoy. I know I have to sacrifice something. We're in a nation that leaders, they are not interested in sacrifice. The truth is, over allowance. The truth is, it's not to talk the talk. Some of them, they talk very well. Sometimes when I watch them. But it's not about your talk, it's about doing the work. Doing the work. Working the talk is what brings the progress. Some people are eloquent. their natural element, they can talk the dead, they don't realize, say, ah, you are the one talking, okay, let me go back again. In confusion, it's not about talking. The Bible says that empty vessels, they make the loudest noise. But a true leader must live the life of sacrifice. There are no true leaders that I know. True leader. If we even look at the body of Christ, I can see this leader, as I'm looking at them, I'm seeing sacrifice in their life. They have everything at their disposal, but they don't just do anything. They do anything that people see that they do that is very elaborate. It's because they are using it to actually touch life. The life that they touch is more than those things. In the book of 1 Peter chapter 5, 1 to 4. 1 Peter chapter 5, 1 to 4. Talking about the leaders, although they call leaders elders here. The elders which are among you, I exhort, whom am also an elder, and a witness of the suffering of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. See the flock of God which is among you. They are giving the leaders instructions that you have to feed, not to feed yourself first. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not be constrained, but willing, not by constraint, but willingly, not for fieldy lucre. Look, that means fieldy monetary gain. That's what that means. But of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive what? A crown of glory that fadeth not away. Praise the Lord. This happened to be the situation. When leaders don't know the definition of, I start to start from the political system, the political parties, we have to redefine who should contest. It has to be redefined. There is somebody that is ready to sacrifice. There is somebody that is ready to lay down whatever accolade that has been achieved. And somebody that is not thinking of just somebody that is thinking of a good name. Remember that a good name is better than rubies, better than silver, better than gold. It has to start with the redefining who we are allowing to even contest. And that will form Nigeria blessed with so many resources. Many nations are like that. But I've come to discover that many nations that have so many wonderful resources, their citizens are wallowing in poverty. What is the connection? Why is it like that? Many nations, including yours truly, the resources of this nation, many top world nations, they are envious of it. Yet, many people cannot make ends meet because the raw material being there does not translate to the wealth if the mind is poor. If the mind is poor, give a poor-minded person billion, it will be lost over time. Give a rich-minded person some few thousand to go and do business. When you come back to check the person, he has modified. I pray that the Almighty God will rescue this land. Yeah. I pray that the Almighty God shall rescue this land. Yeah. Many of the peers of Nigeria, many of them are doing well, are doing better. The one that we gained independence together, Brazil, some years ago, they were like, but now, just a few decades. In which year was it? Was it in the early part of our independence? Nigeria and Brazil, they were to go into the manufacturing of these jets, so they set up the industry. As of a few years ago, Brazil is set. They have come up with exporting all those jets to make billions of money. Our own factory that we set up at Kaduna is furniture, the city, want to be city. Furniture. But God will heal our land. I say, God will heal our land. Many nations that are not even as wealthy, they are turning things around. When a nation is not future-minded, the nation will misbehave in the present at the detriment of the future. That was what happened to Joseph when he got to the palace. He made assessment of what was. Ah, you have been 7 years, 7 years, 7 years. Okay. Say that this is what we will do. So percentage of what we will be getting, stack it aside. For the time that there won't be much, for the time that the oil market will dwindle, and Nigeria has been at the mercy of the market, the market of oil. 70% above of our foreign capital come from oil, natural resources. When a nation is feasting on just what is there, the nation cannot prosper much. There are other resources. I'm not interested in tapping it. They just focus on what? The agricultural. And one thing about nations that research has been brought out, that how come the nations that are so wealthy with resources, they struggle, they are among the third world nations. Why? This is one of the reasons. The tendency for the government not to really need any, the contribution of the tax payment of the tax by some nations, some years back. If you pay your tithe, it does not matter, because they are not looking for that one. That is not what is bringing the money. And if they are not looking, if the resources that is making them the nation that they call themselves to be is not coming from the masses, it's coming from the natural thing, why should I listen to you anyway? What do you have to offer? What are you bringing to the table? But a nation that is developing in IT, that they know that the vast majority of the world is because people are setting up business, people are coming up with invention. You know, the world has gone past the time that the oil dons, they are the one in charge. Look at those names. Bill Gates does not have any hardware. We are talking about the knowledge. The world has moved from, but many people don't know. Many nations don't know. And those nations are investing in knowledge, in researches to get wealth. India of late has started, I don't know what they are rated, but they are doing well now. Previously they were not, even with all their diversity and all the poverty there, but they are among, I think, the number eight now. Because they discovered that the world is moving from your resources. Is what software, what do you have to produce that will benefit the world, and scooping all the money. The richest in the world now, they don't talk about having some resources that they are tapping. But some nations, like our nation, they are still focused. So when the market drops, you see the recession. But there are other things that they have left. And when a nation, just like I told you, it just getting the wealth, people will say they will come up with, so the people that are there, they will be interested in coming up with policies that will just favor the elites. Because what your tax, when you bring your tax, the 70%, over 70% of the resources that they make in the nation is coming from the oils that we are getting. So what they are paying as a private person, it does not make sense to them. So why should we listen to you? So the health sector, you don't need to listen to you anyway. The education sector, you shout. They give you, because no matter if, but even if the people, they have encouraged establishment, and many of the resources of the nation come from the private people, just like foundations. The taxpayer, every human being, if there is problem like this, they just call a particular number, they rush there, because the people are the ones that are making the nation. They are not depending, they are not focused on resources, because the resources they cannot be tapping in. Better you say, because if the people should protest, it could shut down the government. Until the government starts thinking that way, just trying to encourage researches, put more into IT, into knowledge, then we don't be saying the whole story. Being free is not, or being bound is not about being in a confinement. You could be on the in the open and be bound.
Yes, sir.
In the mind. And the greatest bondage is the bondage of the mind. You could be free, you could be outside there, and not really be free. Until our leaders get to that point. When you are free on the inside, it doesn't matter of time. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7, Proverbs 23, verse 7. As a man thinketh, where? It will eventually become it. It is about the thinking. There's this story of a man, and the old man, the son, happened to be in the prison. And the son had been helping him, one rascal like that, helping to do his farming at the particular season. And he now wrote the letter to the son. He said, now you are in this season. I want to plant cassava this year, but I'm missing you because nobody will help me to do the plowing, get people to help me to just cultivate it, and me waiting for harvest. I'm missing you. I don't know how to do it without you. I have to find a way to do it without you. He wrote the letter to the guy in prison. And that guy got the letter and wrote back, Dad, please don't make any attempt to touch the ground of our farm, because I have eaten the money that I stole that have brought me here, all the loot that have been, they are inside that place. Don't touch that ground. Your son, I love you too. The next day, the father just saw police. Obviously, they are ready to I was going. They just saw the police. They just came around the house with all DPO, ASP, wah. They put everything, they killed all the place. They found nothing. He went back. Then the father now wrote back to him. But I never knew that you even had influence in the prison. That even the police chiefs and the boys, that they are the ones that you now send, you are too good. But the moral of that story, you will be bound physically. But if you are free, you will utilize resources to the fullness, even to the benefit of your life. I prophesy in any age of your life that you are bound, receive divine freedom. You can receive divine freedom in the name of Jesus Christ. If, regardless of how people have been misbehaving, our leaders, they are cooperating to oppress, you just keep your focus. There's a song that I told the technical people that they want me to be. It's one of the songs that I always love by one guy called Larry Safra. It's a song that it brings emotion in me. It makes me to just think that yes, if your mind is free, let them do anything to you in your body, you will see achieve your goal. I don't know whether I think it's in my class on the table or somewhere. But maybe if they are able to get it, you know, he's talking about no matter what the good, you can always be free. And I pray that Nigeria, as we are celebrating trusting God, that this year, 56th independence, will be different.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say it shall be different.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because we still serve a God. And another thing is that we cannot just keep blaming the Europeans, the people that colonized us. We know that they did some things. They set up constitution and some system that will favor them, always coming to power, and we depending on them one way or the other. We know that. But we cannot continually be giving excuses. Our peers that were like that today, they suffer initially, but they are not come up. So we have no excuse anymore. The life of the Brazil, they are cooperating with Chile and Argentina now. They are our contemporaries. So now, what they are making us to say, stop giving us, rise up. You can always, even if you are falling down, Micah chapter 7 verse 8. Micah chapter 7 verse 8. And just to stop giving excuses, let our leader, with all of us, put our hands on the deck and make it work. We just come against me, oh my enemy. When I fall, oh heaven, I shall arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord shall be a light unto me. That man by the pool of Bethesda, he kept on giving excuses. John chapter 5, from verse 4 to maybe 6 or so. John chapter 5, from verse 4. Jesus time made him. He saw him that he had been in that situation for a long time. Now that we now be made, who was giving excuses. The idea, let's stop giving excuses. It's because of this. It's because the people that left the government, they did not leave something behind. Start bringing something. Go to five, when Jesus Christ came. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 30 and 8 years. 6. When Jesus saw him lie, and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, not like Nigeria, he had been a long time in this particular case, he said unto him, will thou be made whole? He started giving excuses. The blessed man answered him, sir, I have no man, I have no connection. When the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another step down before me. Jesus Christ was saying, will you be made though? Do you want to be made though? Yes! Then let me do it for you. I have no man. Excuses. Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. 9. And immediately, the man was made whole. And took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. He said, rise up, take up your bed and walk. Jesus said that, we watch you now. I won't touch this man. He does not know that he has all the potential to rise. And what I will do for him is just to tell him what to do. Not that I have no man to take me. I've been on this bed all this while. And anytime I'm trying to come, when the angels, Jesus said, did not even answer him. He said, arise, take up the bed and walk. And the Bible said that immediately the man rose. And Jesus Christ purposely did not touch him. Try to pass a message that everything that you require to rise is already in you. I don't need to even touch anything. Everything we need to rise in Nigeria is there. We just forgot to open our eyes and to make us believe. And God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Something happened in 1996, Atlanta. Nigeria was playing against Brazil. That game, Nigeria dealt with Nigeria. Nigeria dealt with Brazil. No, in fact, it was Brazil that was dealing with Nigeria. 3-1. 77th minute. 3-1. So Nigeria were crying. No, some people, they are emotional. They were crying. Some people shut their TV. They are not watching. It's not, we know that, you know, the Brazil, everybody knew that they were a world champion. But not like this. They didn't want it to be like this. What made it painful? You know, this call was not for me. But the dreaming. Oh my God. You know, and sometimes Nigerians supporters, when the thing pains them, they will not start supporting. They will not just say, hey, go open it. Some people that don't want to see it, you see it on their face, they don't be looking at it. All the green, white, green, you see that it's pages. Praise the Lord. 77 minutes. 3 months. That's about 10 minutes or so to the end of the match. And Brazil actually had the barrier of stars. Rivaldo, Bebeto, Carlos, all those people, they were actually there. So it's expected, but we didn't expect, let this be gentle or not. All of a sudden, at the 78 minutes, Victor Ekuba, he just put in the second goal. And the whole thing changed. Nigeria became motivated. And the fans that were already sleeping, they woke up and said, ah, okay, I didn't deal with this like this. Let us maintain, maintain. Then the Brazilian people, all of a sudden, they just started misbehaving. And at the 90th minute, Kanu Manko, he just put the ball over there and 20 meters to he scored. Oh my God! That's when you see the chair. I said, I believe you will win. They are not open. And at that time, there was a particular system rule. They called it golden rule, and that is the golden rule. That's like the first time that was scored. About 3 minutes to the end, Kanu Manko again. I'm seeing you with him. You know, he went. Oh my God. I'm already seeing the goal already. That's how Nigeria will score again. That is how Nigeria will come from down and go to the top again. But we have to believe that with God, all things are possible. Let's not start saying that, this thing can never know. In the book of Mark chapter 10, verse 27. Mark chapter 10, verse 27. And even Matthew chapter 19, is the same thing that he said. And Jesus looked upon them, said, with men, what? It is impossible. But what? Not with God. People that say that Nigeria can never have, they don't know God. But not with God. For with God, all things are possible. Regardless of how they are treating us. The people outside, the people inside, the people ruling, the people everywhere. Just maintain your freedom in your mind. Just know that you will make it. Regardless of what is it. Remember that we should not look at the things that are seen in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 18. Then I look, why we look not at the things that are seen, the struggle that are seen, the fair increase, the market prices. Then don't look at it. Then that the one you cannot see that is in your mind is greater than that one. Why we look at the things we have seen? But are the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal. That means that temporal they will pass away. But the things which are not seen are eternal. Just listen, the technical people told you that they are ready without song. He just trying to tell you that even if you find yourself in any prison experience, and people are intimidating you, oppressing you, that your leaders are even exalted, but maintain your freedom in your mind. Once they cannot get your mind to get you bound, you will rise. Let's hear it something now before we go.
The more you take my rights away,
Nation, woe unto that nation. But if the nation is upright, then they will be given. Righteousness does what? That's not a nation. But sin what? It's a reproach to any people. Are you here in your own personal life? You are a nation. You are a nation yourself. You are a nation. God was talking to Rebecca. Because she was pregnant with a set of twins. And that would be the first recorded set of twins. And she was feeling somehow. And she now went to God. How am I feeling like this? I think that should be in Genesis 25, 22 to 25. How am I feeling like this? God said that because you have two nations in your womb. God was calling his a baby a nation. Because truly you are a nation. When you are living in sin, the reproach that comes with sin will be upon the person. You will be free, and your freedom starts with you giving your life to Christ. And if you are giving your life to Christ, congratulations. But the freedom will be activated if you receive the power to live a holy life. Salvation is not the beginning and the end of the story in kingdom of God. No, it's just the beginning. But after salvation, there is what they call sanctification. Sanctification is you allowing the word of God to correct you, to change you, and the path of the just will be growing, shining brighter and brighter and brighter. The more you know God, the more you are able to break free from sin. Sin is a spiritual force that has held people bound. God and the word of God is also a spiritual force that sets people free. So it's the one that you increase into your life that will determine who is going to gain ground. It's so simple. When you don't expose yourself to the word of God, you will find yourself, you want to break the habit, you cannot break it. Why? Because the measure of God in you has no reason to the level that it will just incapacitate to what have been there all the while. But you have a choice to make a decision. You are just a decision away from freedom. A decision to live a holy life. You are not the one that has the power. That's what people don't know. You don't have the power to live a holy life. Who can live a holy life? It's only God that has that power. But he gives the power to the people that are willing. Willing to confess their sin and forsake, then he will not give them the power. The book of Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. God said that we should come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and grace in time of... Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time. There are two things that you have to obtain here. You obtain mercy for the wrong that you have done. Then you now receive grace not to do it again. Some people, they just obtain mercy and they go again. They go back. They have not received grace. They will go and do it again. But there are two laws that obtain mercy. But don't just go with mercy. Just say, grace not to do this thing. Let it come upon me. And the power will just come upon the person. When you get to that point again, you just find yourself being able to rise above it because God has given you the grace. Can you bow your head? Are you here? You want God's touch to receive that mercy and to get that grace. And you are not ashamed of God. You don't care who is sitting beside you, it doesn't matter. They are not your God anyway. You just want to make things right with God. You want to be free. Whenever you are, lift up your right hand. Even if you're outside, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Even if you're outside, the usher will get to you. God is part of you. On a day like this that we are trusting God for Nigeria, your own freedom is on. God bless you, God bless you. Lift up your hand. Lift up your hand, God bless you. And he will give you a card. Once they drop the card in your hand, you can put down your hand. They will give you a card. God bless you. Lift up your hand. God bless you. God bless you. Lift up your hand. God bless you. I'm proud of you. And God is also proud of you. Because there are those that are not ashamed of me yet. When it comes to the time that I will speak for them too, I will not be ashamed of them. Thank you, Lord. Wherever you are, if you have received the card, can you just repeat after me? Say, my heavenly Father, I thank you for your word that has come to me today. receive all the glory. I am sorry for all the wrong that I have ever done and that is recorded against me. Let the blood of Jesus cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Make me holy and make me whole. The power to live above sin, give it to me now. The grace that I need to be great, grant it unto me also. Thank you, because you have heard my prayer. Till I see you in glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Heavenly Father, I commit this to your lovely children that have made up their mind to say bye-bye to the world, to say bye-bye to sin, to say bye-bye to the devil. Father, I have signified it by receiving the card. Please take their name. Write their name in the book of life. In case their name has been written before, maybe they are backslidden, Father, restore them fully. Your Holy Spirit that guides, that leads, that instructs, that inspires, that energizes, inject into them afresh. As they be leaving this place, let them be leaving this place, new people. And let them never go back to the world again. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Shall we ask for faith, everybody? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We are going to put our mouth and pray and say, Father, touch my mind.
Touch my mind.
And set me free.
In the name of Jesus.